Welcome, friends, to another r/I don't work here lady video. As always, if you enjoy this video, please make sure to hit that subscribe button. And our first story of the day is by Bananacute. Guy gets mad because I'm not a nurse. This just happened at a gas station while I was on my lunch break. I work in animal care, so I wear scrubs. I'm in line and a guy comes up behind me, practically whispering in my ear, almost sensually, "Hey, you a nurse?" Creeped me out to begin with. Why are you so close to me and why are you whispering in my ear? I just said no, sorry, and went back to my own little world. "Why are you dressed like a nurse?" he asks, sounding a little annoyed with me. "I work in animal care. We wear scrubs too." Usually I don't feel the need to explain myself, but I did anyway. "Do you know where I can get a vaccine?" I say, lots of places. I'm not sure about this area. You can Google it or check the government website." They say, "How do you not know? Healthcare workers know this crap." "I just don't, sorry," I say firmly, trying to end the conversation. "Whatever, unless," and mutters away to himself. It's my turn in line, I pay and go to leave, and this guy gives me such a dirty look. Like, what the heck, man? I was super polite and usually I'm not. Not everyone that wears scrubs is a human nurse, and not every healthcare worker knows at all times when and where you can be vaccinated. Google it. Assuming this is in the US, would the amount of focus the government's put on trying to make sure as many people can get vaccinated as possible? It's such an easy thing now to Google, and I think they have some kind of like text line where you can just text it with some basic info and get told exactly where to go. As it stands right now, I think it would be insane in the US if you weren't able to find where to go with a minimal amount of effort. So, let's say you went to a gas station, and while you were inside, you saw somebody with scrubs on. Would your first instinct be, "Oh, that must be a healthcare worker"? Or would you be thinking maybe a little bit more broader than just healthcare worker? Let me know if that would come to your mind first in the comments down below. This next story is by Cookie Stew. A lady with a wrong number almost gave me a job. I work with my grandpa in his little business, and usually people here don't expect young people to work. So many adults have described me as hardworking, but the truth is, I'm a lazy pig. One day, I receive a call, and they told me if I wanted the job. So, as I just really want to have some money, I said it was okay, and asked what the work's about. Lady over the phone told me someone with the same first and last name as someone I know recommended me for work. I was like, whoa, then I do come off as hardworking then. For a friend of my parents to recommend me, I must be leaving a good impression on adults. And as I keep quiet, the lady says another woman has told her I was pretty good at cleaning. I'm not. So then I started to get suspicious. Me? Good at cleaning? No. I asked for the name of the woman who told her that, without saying the "I'm not good at cleaning" part, of course. And she tells me a name I've never heard of before. I say I don't know any woman named like that, to what the lady answers me that I'm the recommender's sister-in-law. So, I don't even have a crush on somebody, let alone a husband. As I say that I really don't know her, the lady rushes to ask if I'm not insert name here, and I don't work for insert company names label, cleaning houses, and take care of old people, and if I don't live in city's name. I say, no, I'm sorry, you have the wrong number. They say, oh, well, sorry for bothering you. And I say, but I would like to take the job. Beep. She hung up, but called me 3 minutes later to tell me someone had the same number as mine, and that it was a teenager talking over the phone. For a moment, she was going to give me the job, dramatically saying, how could she not tell me? I was going to give her the job. And, well, she said a lot of things until she waited for a reply. Maybe she thought that by calling again, she would reach the lady? They knew each other since when she called me, she told me she had been chatting with the lady who I was supposed to be. I just answered, I'm sorry I didn't tell you. I was confused as well, and hung up. And that's the story of how I almost got a job that wasn't meant for me. It might be rude of me, I don't know, but I kind of hope this lady feels absolutely embarrassed for not only making the wrong call to somebody, but then calling them back, thinking they were another person, and ridiculing them to their own face, basically. If there was ever a moment where you're laying down in your bed, looking at your ceiling, and you just have these like PTSD flashback moments, this would be one of those. Our next story is by Tuna Tofu. Please call my boss. Here's his number. So I've been reading this sub for a while. I never thought it would happen to me, but lo and behold, my very own encounter with a Karen. I was at the Wally World Mart store, where I rarely go, buying home repair items for some work I'm having done in my house. The depot didn't have these items, so I had to go to Wally World. So as usually happens, the very item I needed was way back on the shelf, requiring me to remove most of the other ones to get to it. Not being a Karen myself, I put them all back rather than leaving them all over the floor. I guess the Karen saw me doing what appeared to be stocking the shelves and made some gross assumptions. She comes dashing up and starts barking orders at me, something about mixing paint, I don't know, it was all so fast. I heard hardly anything she said, so I just continued putting the items back on the shelf and shopping for what I needed. Karen said, "Well," I say, "I don't know, ask somebody." She says, "If you want to keep your job, you better get your butt over there and mix this paint for me." I say, "No, I don't work here, leave me alone." She says, "I'm reporting you to your manager. You stay right there. You have really messed up now. Who do you work for?" So my peeps, I pulled out my cell phone and looked up the person I work for. Oh, and be sure to keep trying until the answers, because my manager really loves to get feedback on his employees. I had maliciously complied by providing the contact info for the CEO of the large Fortune 500 defense contractor I actually work for. Her odds of getting him on the phone aren't good, but even on the slim chance she does, he isn't likely to care that one of his 100,000 employees was snarky to some Karen while shopping at Wally World. "No, no, not the CEO, I want your manager, you know, the one with the blue vest, looks tired, sits in their office all day on the iPad rather than doing their job. I want to speak to that person. They'll clearly care about this wrongdoing." Our next story is by another person. I'm not the DMV. This happened a decade and a half ago, just after I got out of the Air Force. I'd returned to my hometown and wanted to get a phone number that was local, so I decided to get a phone through a month-to-month provider since it was cheap. I pretty much immediately started getting phone calls regarding people's driver's license. I would answer and tell people they had the wrong number all the time. Thankfully, it wasn't at all hours of the day because of DMV hours. Most of the people were understanding. I felt bad for most of them because a lot of them were elderly. Unfortunately, some of them didn't understand why I couldn't talk to them about their driver's licenses. On a few occasions, I'd get into yelling matches because they ended up being a Karen. On several occasions, people would just start the conversation with their name and driver license number. Someone left me a message with name, driver license number, social security number, date of birth, phone number, etc. After about a month, I decided to call my phone number, but with the area code of the state capital. That's how I found out which department had my same number. I asked them to make sure they made the area code bold and or italicized to make sure it was easier for people to understand where they needed to call. When the DMV answered my call regarding what was going on, they started getting snippy with me, saying you can't talk to people about these things. My response in my most condescending tone was, "No crap. Do you think I want these people calling me? Do you know what I can do with this information? Would you like me to collect this information?" "That's right. I didn't think so." After that, the conversation got a lot more cordial after that. The lady on the other end really realized how bad it could be. The DMV is really lucky I'm an honest and non-malicious individual. After about 2 weeks, the phone calls got very few and far between. About 6 months later, I changed my phone carrier to someone better because the service really was subpar, which also came with a new phone number. Getting an all-new phone number is definitely sometimes a crapshoot. When I got my most recent number, I kind of lucked out, but it really starts to become apparent around election time, where all of a sudden all these volunteer groups start texting your number based off of whatever database they managed to find it on, asking you to go out and vote. And all of a sudden I'll get texts like, "Hey Jasmine, I'm so-and-so with Rock the Vote organization. I'm texting to see if you voted yet, blah blah blah." Or, "Hey Gerald, so-and-so with so-and-so, are you thinking of voting, blah blah blah." And I'll just ghost it because I don't want to end up on any newer database, that's for sure. This next story is by Tadair, another wrong number story. My significant other and I got our first place together back in the 90s. All happy and just settling in, we got our utilities set up and with it a new home landline. Not even an hour after the line went live, we got our first call. The person wanted to rent a pay-per-view movie. I told them they had the wrong number and went on with my day. Then it happened again and again, all hours of the day and night, almost never more than 2 hours between calls. I looked up the number for TCI's pay-per-view number and it was one off from ours. Like ours was 555-8099 and theirs was 555-8090. I called AT&T and complained about it and asked them to change our number, but they said I had to pay for a new number. I refused. I then called TCI and told them my problem and informed them that I asked AT&T to change our number because of the problem. They asked why they should care. I said if they asked AT&T to waive the fee for changing, they would. If they didn't, I'd just tell every person their movie was set to start. They said go ahead, so I did. After a week of people getting mad that their 2 a.m. adult entertainment wasn't actually working, AT&T sent me a letter saying they needed to change my number for service reasons. Well, I guess that shows you what a good motivator interrupting someone's access to does. In most cases, doing something like this, you might be able to coast for over a month doing this. But you start messing up people's good times and, AT&T comes practically busting the door down. And our final story of the day is by Staring at the Sun, featuring SZA. Girls mistake me for Olympian, ask me to help them move. My ego almost got us all killed. Filming a video at work the other day, we helped film the safety videos for other people's places of work. This particular video had a quippy bit along the lines of, "Even an Olympic weightlifter shouldn't attempt these heavy maneuvers without noting proper form and procedure." I do almost exclusively behind-the-scenes stuff, but occasionally pitch in when we have non-speaking bit parts like this that aren't worth coordinating an actor for. So I put on this very hokey Olympic weightlifter costume that was literally a pair of spandex shorts and a shirt that said weightlifter on it, with the Olympic rings and the US flag sewn on. Probably nothing like what Olympians actually wear, but much easier and cheaper for getting the joke across. I pretended to execute this particular company's operations improperly while acting in pain, and the whole thing took maybe 20 minutes, but I still had a lot of work to do and we were way behind, so I didn't find the time to stop and change back to my regular clothes. End of the day came, and the whole project had taken a lot longer than we anticipated, so we were all exhausted and eager to get out of there. I hurried home and was just walking up to the front of my apartment building when this gorgeous woman flags me down. I did a double take because surely she couldn't be talking to me. Something critically important to know at this juncture, I'm pretty much the picture of average physically and personally. Not a pity party, I work hard for that average, things could frankly be a lot worse. But anyways, this becomes relevant, and not just because of my sad dating life, hang in. So this stunning woman touches my shoulder, rendering me speechless and also confirming I'm who she was after, and says, "Oh, perfect. Hi, my name is Tanya. I'm your neighbor across the hall. I don't think we've formally met before. Look, my girlfriend's moving in on the third floor, and the moving company she hired doesn't have a COI, so the landlord isn't letting them up. Any chance you could help us? I mean, clearly it wouldn't be a challenge for you." She again brushes against me flirtatiously, so as this is happening, I've realized she's seen my costume shirt from the shoot and inferred I'm some kind of world-class weightlifter. I don't want to perpetuate a lie, but I don't want her to lose interest in me. This is a beautiful woman right in my building, and I figured as long as she doesn't explicitly ask, "Hey, were you in the Olympics?" it isn't exactly lying. The convoluted plan I formed in my head was that I'd help her move, because even I can lift boxes. And then, once we had a date scheduled, and she asked me about my Olympic glory, I'd say, "Oh, that? No, let me explain." And it would be a funny misunderstanding we could look back and laugh about, because by then enough time would have passed that she would see other worthwhile qualities in me. Like how I can keep any houseplant alive and have really organized closets. Basically the same as being an Olympian, right? So I confidently tell her, "Not a problem. What needs moving?" I get over to the curb near the truck, and the first things I see are a whole sectional couch, a five-tiered wooden armoire, a grandfather clock, a massage chair, a treadmill, and a box spring. Just lifting my regular boxes when I'd moved, like with plates and linens and stuff, was a major physical undertaking for me that had required multiple breaks, and I didn't even live in a unit accessed by stairs. But I was determined to impress this girl, and more importantly at that point, not horrifically humiliate myself in a scene that would surely spread to the rest of the tenants. So I once again allowed a convoluted, not so much plan, this time as delusion, to form for me mentally. I figured there were three of us, me, her, and her friend, so none of the objects could be too difficult to transport. Plus, I had just spent all day listening to professionals instruct on the safest way to lift heavy objects. So we started with the heirloom armoire, because it was the closest to the door and the most valuable item. So what her friend was most worried about leaving on the street. They actually wanted one of the girls to stay out there to watch the stuff, but I knew that way, I'd have no chance of getting any of those things up three flights of stairs in a manner befitting a pro athlete, so I convinced them that for their own safety, in regard to weight distribution, there needed to be three of us. We lifted the armoire. We got it to the door. I was immediately physically and mentally dying just from having to step over the little hump between the door and the lobby. I felt like my arms had been crushed by a steamroller by the time we got to the stairs, and my core was twisted up like a pretzel. I was so tense, I could barely get a breath in. I was grateful that the armoire was at least obscuring my face, because I probably looked like a high diver just before they hit the water. And worse, the girls were understandably not making too an intense effort to carry their end, figuring I had it covered, so they were making unlabored casual conversation with me, and I was too strained to give any real response. Then we got to the stairs. In the back of my mind, where my conscience probably is, I knew I had to stop putting up this ridiculous act and confront the fact that I could not move all this stuff. But the logic part of my brain was telling me that there was no way to stop on the stairs while simultaneously resting the armoire. If I set it down for even just a second, it would slip because of the width and the angle of the stairs. Just when I started to feel the lightheadedness really intensifying, I tripped over my own feet, and in an effort to steady myself, I shot a hand out onto the banister and lost my grip on my end. I yelled out, both because I wanted to warn the girls who were on the other side before they were crushed by this thing, and because it fell onto my toes, and it went crashing down the stairs and shattered down onto the concrete entry floor. The girls managed to get out of the way though, which is really the important thing. I then had to explain that I was not, in fact, an Olympic weightlifter or lifter of any things of any kind, and I will likely have to buy her a new armoire because I'm sure this one is broken. I'm also sure at least two of my toes are broken, so I got karma for being disingenuous. Luckily, the neighbor and her friend, my new neighbor, were pretty understanding about the situation. And when my toe was healed, I planned to draw inspiration from this otherwise abysmal experience to maybe, sometimes, hit the gym. I mean, if you're in that deep, it's good that you came clean and just admitted what the deal actually was. But once you're in that deep, maybe you could have just said, oh, I pulled a leg muscle or something, and maybe just hope the lie continued on. But despite all the lying OP did, in the very end, I think that they did the right thing in admitting it, as painful as it may have been, both physically with the toes and emotionally, with admitting that you're a liar and not an Olympic weightlifter. But with that being said, that's a wrap on another bunch of stories here today. As always, if you guys have any favorite videos of this bunch, let me know which one in the comments down below and why. And if you enjoyed the stories in general, if you could subscribe to this channel, it'd mean a lot to me. I make these videos daily, and it's by far and away the best way to support my channel. So no matter what you did, whether it was subscribing or liking, leaving a comment, I just appreciate the heck out of you guys. And as always, I'll be back tomorrow with even more stories right here on the Storytime channel.